I think what we need to do is to now is to find out what some people have done and how effective it is in terms of decolonizing ourselves. Because every time I sit and listen to all of us here when we're talking about things, you know, we all straddle in the fence. You know, on the one end we're talking about white way, on the other end then we step over and turn into the black world and we're talking. So we're talking from two worlds, so we got to work out which world do we belong to. That's what we have to do. If we're going to make progress and go forward here, we either got to be work out whether we black fellas under our law and custom, or whether we half caste, stuck in the middle and don't know where we belong, or whether we belong over here in an assimilated society and work with those bastards over there to down and oppress our people further over here. Because I see those black fellas stuck in that over there thinking they can change it. I see them as suffering the Stockholm Syndrome, yeah? They are representing the oppressor's mind to try and convince us that we're going to go into those people and become part of those people who are oppressing us. So we here have to make a decision about where it is that we're coming from. And if we can't do that here in this circle here, well then we got bloody no hope of working out a pathway going forward. No hope whatsoever, yeah? And so we have to work that out ourselves. Now, if I can, I know everybody wants to say something, but let's get down to what people have done and how they've succeeded and what we've succeeded on the ground in terms of sovereignty and exercising sovereign actions on the ground. And if I can just ask, and for us to bear with her, because I want to ask Narissa of Najin. Now, Narissa comes from where Eddie and them are. They have united as tri-nations now. There's Najin, Yidinji, and what's the other one?
Mbabram.
Right, so these three nations. Now these three nations, whilst they've gone through the native title process, they have now advanced themselves and gone into their own sovereignty and began to work from within their own communities and work amongst their people. And they've treated to become a tri-nation with each other. And Narissa has stood up and said, well, we need someone to sacrifice and make a move to move outside the white system totally. Yeah? And I'd like to invite Narissa of Najin to stand up and explain what she did and the subsequent effects that that's had on her, her family and her people. And so, and we need to understand this if we're saying that we are black fellas and we're outside that system. So I'll if we can just bear with Narissa, because she's got a terrific story to tell.
Okay, I'm Narissa and I'm from far north Queensland, from the rainforest with Uncle Eddie. I came here I came here to the 40th anniversary a few years ago, and I heard lawyers talking about we never become naturalised and you don't have to vote. So I went home and I did my research. Why don't we have to vote? Why have we never been naturalised? So I looked at all of that. We had our own sovereign territorial jurisdiction. So for me, that's the... So for me, that's Najin. That's my sovereign territorial jurisdiction. My people were deported from my territorial jurisdiction to the mission of Yarrabah, to another mission. That's not our territorial jurisdiction. That's what the British government did. So then I had to look at consolidating acts. Consolidating acts means which acts match together and line up. That's your Migration Act, that's your your Aliens Act, your Citizenship Acts. You have to look at all of that to work out, why don't me or my people fit in this system? Why have we never been naturalized? Because we were here first. The British government we did not cede up our sovereignty. They did not defeat us in war. So what gave them the legal right to move my people from my territorial jurisdiction to a foreign territorial jurisdiction? So I had to look at all of that. And then
the jury
So
come forward in time with the voting now. I don't have to vote. Well, I said to the Commonwealth government and the state government. I am not voting because your statutory law says, based on my race, I do not have to vote.
Franchise Act.
Stop. It's the 1902 Franchise Act. You have to look at that. Section 4, subsection B. It talks about who are disqualified from voting within that jurisdiction. Us, based on our race, were disqualified from voting because we're not a part of this jurisdiction. Legally and politically, we're not a part of it. That's why the Constitution does not apply to us, because of our legal and political status.
No, 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 no.
Juridico, politico, political relationship to state. Oh, we don't have it.
This is my mother, Isabel, so she'll butt in every now and then.
But there is no juridico, political relationship to state as citizenship. It doesn't apply to us. It's got to be recognised.
Let her finish, please. Let her finish.
Domestic police state.
Mothers, lateral violence, mothers.
Mothers.
Go on, keep going.
And then you look at the Electoral Acts, because with the Franchise Act, you have to qualify for and a franchise to a jurisdiction based on your political status. So with the Franchise Act, the Consolidating Act are the Electoral Acts. Consolidating Acts to that is the Alien Acts. Consolidating Act to that is the Naturalisation Act. So you see now why, legally and politically, the statutory law tells me I am not compelled to vote. Okay, so I challenge this. They sent me a $20 fine, and I said, well, I'm going to challenge this based on your statutory law. Your statutory law says I don't have to do that, and you're forcing me to do that. So you show me now, Crown Law in Queensland, where I have to vote. Crown Law said to me, I feel like jumping out of the glass plate window of the third level.
Into oncoming traffic.
Justice Irwin, when I went to court, I had to go to court in 2012 for not voting because I was now challenging the Crown, why I don't have to vote. And I was challenging the Crown on my political status. So they had to counteract the argument. The Crown Law solicitor, Solicitor Ling, he was a Chinese lawyer. So when Justice Irwin said to him, well, what are you going to say to her? What's your response? Why, based on her race, she doesn't have to vote? He says, well, that could apply to me because I'm Chinese. The justice says, no, it doesn't. It applies to that race of people. So then I took it a step further and I thought, okay, I'm winning here. It was a constitutional matter arising, it was. And he said to me, you have to notify the Attorney Generals of every state and territory and the federal. So I did that. And they said to me, the Attorney Generals, we will not intervene in this court case, but we will keep a close eye on it. And I knew I was winning every step of the way, and I know I'm still winning right now. So I took it a step further. I came out of the system 2 years later, but I had to plan everything. I had to plan that I was healthy. I had to plan that I was financially supported, emotionally supported,
psychologically.
I had to plan all this. Yes. My tribe do that for me. My elders do that for me. My family do that for me. They support me in every way I need supporting. That's the only way I can do this. And I had to step out of the system because I had to prove to all of our people this is the right way to do it. So if you're staying in the system, you're not going to win because you're fighting within their system, within their jurisdiction. And you can't say in their jurisdiction, I'm sovereign. How can you be sovereign if you're holding their contract? You've got to be logical in your thinking.
No, let's go to the next step now.
So I wrote to the, because we're in Queensland, I wrote to Governor Paul DeGiorgi, the Attorney General at that time, it was Jared Blijo, and I wrote to the Federal, George Brandis and Peter Cosgrove, the Governor General.
Yep.
Cr- Queensland sent a response to me because I sent correspondence to them saying, I'm decolonising and so are my tribe. That's what are my intentions. So Queensland said to me, we're going to oppose you and we're going to become your respondent. And they said, we're going to use the cases, two cases, Mabo 2 and Co versus Commonwealth. Yeah, they're the only two cases they're going to use against me. That's easy, you can knock that out.
Yes.
So that's decolonisation, it's easily won.
But it's about your birth certificate.
Okay, the birth certificate. So when you're coming out of the system, the birth certificate is a contract to be in a jurisdiction.
That's right, yep.
So attached to the birth certificate is...
They own you.
Yeah, because I was working at the time. So there's the Medicare, I had to give that back.
Tax file number.
I had to give the tax file number back, the superannuation, I gave it all back. Because I don't need that. I don't need the government telling me what to do. I don't need the government supporting me because I have a tribe. I have a jurisdiction.
Yes.
All I had to prove was statehood. So in international law, statehood is I proved I had a jurisdiction. I proved I had population within my jurisdiction. I proved I had law and custom. And I proved I can trade, my tribes trade. That's why we formed tri-nations. Because in our law and custom, us three tribes, we trade.
And then they sent me a letter, Queensland government. I am now the executor of the deceased estate. And they gave me all of her money.
So is that
all of her insurance, everything. I don't want it, they can have it back. If there is any outstanding debts that she's left back in that old, they can have it. That's
$20 voting coin.
So they can have it. I don't want it, I don't need it.
So the
listen
here.
But you have to be responsible. You can't expect to step out of the system and commit crimes. You have to be responsible. Don't go raping, bashing people.
Stealing
don't
cars,
even think
bikes.
They don't even set your mind towards that. When you come out of the system, you're representing all of us.
Yep. Yes.
So you got to be focused. You got to be on track. Like Richard was saying, you've got to strive towards that common goal.
So if you do wrong, you're committing an act of war?
No. Who's war?
No.
They asked her that in the court case about the criminal code.
Justice Irwin asked me about the criminal code. I said, I don't come under your criminal code. I come under my law and customs. My tribe will deal with me.
Now.
And then about the moral obligation, he said, but I don't go to my way to break the criminal Queensland criminal code to prove it to you. I have a moral obligation.
Because I'm setting a precedent here, I have to role model to everyone else. So I can't go doing stupid things.
One question here, okay. Do you work and you earn a living? How do you do that if you
No, the tribe supports it.
Oh, okay. So you don't get dole or nothing?
No. Nothing.
Because she don't have a medical certificate? A Medicare card.
Yeah. So you surrender everything.
Yeah. I had to because that's all attached to the contract. Yeah. The birth certificate is a contract between you and,
that's
state Queensland.
So for identification, you have a...
I've got my own sovereign
and national identification card.
And you, from your three nations.
Yes. Sure. Right. With my ID, I travel from airport to airport. It's recognised. Because I test
licensed venues where they sell liquor and gamble. So
What about driving vehicles?
No, we haven't tried that one yet.
After the Moramu stunt?
Yeah, Jeremy Geyer, Moramu.
Yeah.
Because he set a bad precedent already, I have to be careful.
Yeah.
Because people are going to say, no, don't. She doesn't know what she's talking about because of what he did over here. So I have to be very careful of what I do.
Eddie.
Now, Uncle Eddie is my elder from my tribe, so he knows what's going on. He can give an input.
Yeah, so be careful here. Yeah. That's good news, isn't it? Everybody wants to jump in. But she's stepping out of the system.
Yes.
So those that are on dialysis, you won't have a dialysis unless you create your own.
Yeah.
So, you don't have the services of the government, see? Very serious. That's why you've got to be smart. Go sovereign where you create your own services. We've got smart kids, we've got doctors, lawyers and all that. So get back on country, go sovereignty.
Yeah.
Create your own services, then do this stuff. See, don't jump into it.
And the thing is,
she's a test now, she's opened the gate for all of
us. When she did this, she gave back her birth certificate, she gave back everything, right? And so she's now to that system, believe it or not, they classify her as a living dead. She's a deceased person.
You have to give everything back attached to the birth certificate because there's a constitution in Queensland, 2001, that provides peace, order and good governance for that commercial entity, which is the birth certificate. So if you don't want to come under that their foreign power and their law, give it all back. Do not be a contract or contracted to it. The other...
that you ask them a question, and to this day they have never answered. Show you where me, your father, so, were naturalised, your grandparents.
When I was in court, I asked them, you now prove to me where my people have been naturalised, where I ceded up sovereignty and my people, or where you defeated me in war.
They can't. So, your name, is your name the same as your name on the birth
certificate?
No. Because you can't own that, eh?
I do not consent to that contract.
Yeah, so you have a totally different name, you're a totally different person.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. And when you come out of the system, if you're going to do something wrong, that's what your elders are there for. They're there to sort you out.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, the other thing.
Yep.
Now, the other, I'll be very blunt with you. The elders have signed a lot of things that they did not understand. They didn't. It's not their fault. They were lied by the government.
Yeah. And because of their misunderstanding, they abused them and they used them.
They were
okay.
Coerced.
Yes. That's right.
They forced upon them. Yes. Is legally null and void.
That's right.
So okay. Because all of these things were signed, it was signed against our rights as young people.
Yeah, yes. Right.
So now I had to step out of the system and get the elders thinking. What have you got in place for her as a young person? There's not much set up. So my elders are working frantically now to set up our jurisdiction and our statehood.
Mm.
It is a huge job. I have to...
The most important thing here, the letter that I wanted her to mention, she received a letter from the government saying, now Nugent G, you are now deceased. You are nothing. So they gave her the sovereignty.
Yes.
Or they have no...
They gave her over because it's
a process, but it's a dangerous one. Mm. So you got to learn it properly. Don't jump into anything.
Yeah, right.
So to us and her, see all this marching and flag and jumping around, it's all irrelevant. There is a way that bypasses it.
Yeah.
So you understand all that now?
Yeah.
But be careful, eh?
Yes.
Learn the steps, and she can teach it to you.
So the other thing, I notify the government agencies that I will be doing this, that I will be here contesting this, challenging this.
Yes.
So I'm not walking into anything blindfolded.
Yeah. And they know that you're coming.
Yeah, they know.
And they've got to get ready for you now.
Yeah.
You have to inform them of your intention. So she informed them of her intention, and they respond back. And we don't accept mail, we only accept email because she doesn't have a postcode.
Yeah, right, yeah, yeah.
Because remember, her jurisdiction doesn't have their copywritten postcode, their copywritten address, their copywritten everything. She's outside into her own.
Her jurisdiction don't exist to them, alright?
Yes. So she's decolonised.
It does exist, they accept it. You were there before us.
Yes. Listen, this gets
better. Oh,
yeah,
come here, come here.
Listen,
Alan. Enlighten me.
Because if you're saying, if we're a foreign power, we're unlawful, all the rest of it, how is that? Were you here before us? So you prove all of that. And that's half proven anyway through your native title, descent determinations. Because you had to prove statehood anyway. You had to prove your jurisdiction, your population, your custom and law, your trading. You proved all of that. So they accept in native title, you have your own sovereign territorial jurisdiction. They accept you have your own statehood.
Have you got email?
Yeah.
Why can you email address?
Can
you
email the workshop with this with you to help you understand?
Where are you going to do the workshop?
Yeah.
What we're thinking about is, you know, once you're here this year, what we need is there's a call for another gathering, you know, so we can get down to some tin tacks.
So
I think this is where, you know, we focus on if tribes want to do it and they make their declarations. It's important that you follow a procedure under international law take us outside of the system. And there is an accepted international process which is called the Unilateral Declarations of Independence.
Yes.
Right.
And so you've got to understand who you have to go through. It's now an internationally accepted method to free yourself from tyranny and from subjugation of a dominant state.
So there's a road laid down.
There is a road. There is a road laid down for all the tribes.
Yeah. So you can't make a blank statement. I'm sovereign. That's my land. It's easy. You find the contrary in their statutory law and use it against them. Contrary means where their laws don't meet.
Yeah.
It's breaching your human rights. Use it against them.
And they cross each other.
Yeah.
And we can find
Eddie.
See, that's true sovereignty. The government recognise it. The world recognise it. So all this marching and all that is irrelevant if you want to go true sovereignty.
Yeah.
Treaties not involved with this thing. Yeah. You want to go sovereignty, but be careful. Yeah. There is a track. She's opened the way. She's opened the gate.
Yeah.
How did she start that? By the axe, learning the axe. Yeah. So get a copy of all the axe. Yeah. My sister there is a walking cyclopedia.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
We got every act known,
yes.
English and Australia.
Yes.
And we go through there, and she's pulled out the ones that she can use against them. They couldn't say anything because it was their words.
Yeah.
The axe.
Yeah.
That's the way you beat them, see?
Yep.
Not by what you know,
yeah,
or your culture. Yeah. Or your culture, yeah, on land and all that comes into it.
Learn their stuff, brother.
But to beat the government is this axe that they already written. They can't change it overnight and say, no, in the morning we change that.
They have to go through the system and change it.
And she blasted them out, see, by using. Only a young girl.
Yeah.
We had to use her as a guinea pig.
Yeah.
But she's done it. Now the gate opens for everyone, but she's done it for us.
It's still trial and error.
Yeah,
trial and error. We haven't come to the end yet.
So that's all.
Still on the journey, still is trial and error, which is why we say to people, be very careful. We don't want martyrs. We don't want anyone locked up, chained, beaten by police, because it is still trial and error. But we do we are very transparent. We tell everyone what we're doing. Don't emulate her yet and copy her yet until we know. Because we don't want anyone to be hurt or harmed. Safety comes first.
Yeah.
Everyone
Eddie,
safe.
Would you like to
say
something,
please?
Marissa, I salute you.
Yeah,
Robin, hey, there we go, Plato. Marissa and, Eddie, I just wondered about the fraudulent Constitution of Queensland, where they turn Queensland into the Brigalow Corporation, and how do you deal with that in terms of, it's happening here in New South Wales, where State Forest and TSRs are probably going to be in the hands of the Brigalow Corp, which is registered in America by the Crown, and so nobody's really picking up on the issues of land in Queensland, in your state particularly, where they're saying that the Brigalow Corp, so nobody owns land in Queensland. How are you going to address that issue in relation to your sovereignty, and how are we going to address it in New South Wales to stop the Brigalow picking up more of the Crown land for nothing that goes back to the Crown?
Before you give it a response to that, can I just say this on that point about nobody owns land in Queensland, really, because it's owned by the Brigalow Corporation. There's an interesting thing. When we fought against the Boulogne Shire Council and we said we're not paying rates on our country, interestingly enough, Justice Philippides in the Supreme Court of Queensland made a very interesting ruling. She put a number of points in there about why she didn't want to accept my arguments and our arguments in there against Brewarrina Shire Council and about ownership of land. And it's interesting that she put a number of things in there and didn't say we won or lost, she just dismissed the whole argument. But interestingly enough, when you look at the last paragraph of her decision in the Supreme Court, Justice Philippides said, the question of ownership of the land and entitlements, this is not between the state government and the Ualio people. This is between the Ualio people and the governor of the state of Queensland, who is the only person who can transfer land.
Mm-hmm.
So that took everything out of the hands of the Queensland Parliament to make any rulings on land.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's a decision that was passed, what, about 14 months ago in the Supreme Court in Queensland. And so what she's done is that she's just basically told the public that the Parliament in Queensland has no authority over the land whatsoever. It's between the Aboriginal people now and the Governor. So you forget about the Parliament, because the Governor is the representative of the Queen, right? And so our fight is not with the Parliament anymore. Our fight is with the Governor, because they're the ones who are holding everything in trust. They work on the advice of their ministers of state in relation to governance, but the person who has the power is the Governor. And that was decided in that court case. And so it's very interesting that you should say nobody owns the land in Queensland. It is all rested, according to Justice Philippides in the Supreme Court of Queensland, said it's between the Governor. The Governor holds title to the land on behalf of the Queen. So that's the one we need to understand. And so when we're talking about going forward with treaties and wanting to talk, you know, the thing is that we're not talking to the right people. We got to understand who you're supposed to be talking with. You got to understand where the power lies. Where is the power, the seat of power? And if we don't know that, where the seat of power is, then really you're just talking to pencil sharpeners, you know? And some of the pencil sharpeners are the ministers who represent themselves in the Parliament as the Crown. Not true. Not true. They do not have, they have certain powers, what they call prerogative powers, because they're ministers of the Queen. But the power is the Queen. And what, where is he? This white fella I called him this morning, sorry, bro. But what Nick said this morning, what Nick Faulkner said, yeah, where this here, where he's talking about the Royal Powers Act, you know, these here, they took all this away, you know, now, you know, Gough Whitlam tried to destroy and have no Queen. But in reality, right now, the law is that we have seven queens to Australia. Yes. There's seven queens, right? We have the Queen of Queensland, Queen of Victoria, Queen of every state. She is an independent queen. And not only that, she's an independent queen to the Commonwealth. So there is no one queen of Australia. Get that, understand that. She's the queen for every state. And she came here in 1986 and signed that document in every state of Australia. She travelled around in 1986, and she signed that document. So she's the Queen of Queensland. So when we talk about the Commonwealth here, we have to be very careful, because the Commonwealth does not represent all those states, because all those states have all they have controlling powers, and so we have to be very careful when we talk about jurisdiction. Yeah, this is things that we need to understand before we start going off talking about things. We have to know who the boss is.
In regards to that, I think
talk up loud so everyone can hear.
What the court sort of finds is that there's not a separate, this is my understanding, there's not a separate queen. There's the Queen of Australia under the Royal Styles and Titles Act.
Yep.
But she acts as queen in right of State of New South Wales. That's the proper terminology.
Yeah.
But she's still that one queen. There's only one queen of Australia.
No. Read the act again.
In right of.
No. Read the act again.
How does that affect?
When you, what we do is that the Commonwealth laws cannot pass laws for states unless the states refer those powers to the Commonwealth. Yeah. Otherwise, the Commonwealth law does not represent properly the state. Yeah. So there are. Powers of reservation of powers that rest with the states, and that's the arrangement with the Commonwealth Constitution. Yes. So we need to understand this very clearly.
Yes.
We need to understand it.
The treaty process that's happening in Victoria now, the one that's beginning in South Australia now, how does that affect those processes? Because the treaties down there, and I've been going to the meetings, is being done by the Premier of Victoria. Mm. And if he's got no authority, then we're going down these meetings for nothing.
Yeah, Eddie.
Is that true?
Yeah. We'll respond to that.
Yeah, in the first place, how kingdoms took over. There were 53 countries the Queen took over.
Right, yeah. Yeah, the Commonwealth.
One is through declaring war, which they didn't do in Australia.
That's right.
One is to sign treaties.
Yeah, which they didn't
do in Australia. Take the land, which they didn't. The other one is to concede. And to answer Brother's question here, Yeah. All what you talk about there is irrelevant.
They got rid of the Governor General,
yeah.
And they...
Yeah. It's irrelevant, yeah, to they, us.
They stole the common sale, yeah, and put it on the documents, yeah, so the same, yeah, as the fraud.
And to brother here, the Queen is not the Queen of Narissa or her country.
That's right.
That's only us. Wasn't about you.
Yes. Yeah.
That's us, the Tri-Nation. You're not Queen of our Tri-Nation. Right. Because we went through the process.
Yeah.
The Government recognises she's sovereignty. The Queen recognises she's sovereignty. See, now you've got to do that. Now this here, that tree, we challenged the Queen, we went, sent our thing and challenged her.
Right.
Give us the documents of those three. When did you declare war on us?
Right.
When did we sign treaty? Give us the document. And when did we
concede our sovereignty?
Yeah. Government knows that. They can't produce it anywhere, anytime.
Yep.
But this is where they're going to trick your brother before you clap. Do you, all the tribes here, do you have regional land council?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
And they come out to you with what? Ilua.
Yes.
That's another name to get you to concede.
Yes.
Sign your land away. When I say it's irrelevant to that, we're still hooked up with forestry and we're still hooked up with mining that can walk over us. You know why? Our elders before us signed the Ilua.
Voluntarily.
Voluntarily. And they signed the land away or the rights away from you. So don't get tricked with Ilua's. Don't sign it.
Yes, don't sign it.
That's the government trick in the first place, to get you to concede.
Right.
And you do it happily, smile on your face right there. Then you jump up and say, how come I'm not getting royalty from mining it? Well, you're the one signed it. Yeah. See, like that. That's how they come. So be careful, like, learn some simple things like that.
Jen.
Yeah.
Now the thing is that what's important here is that if we put those old people up, and any young person say we want to challenge that Ilua in a court, the Ilua will be thrown out simply because the people have been coerced. They've never had independent advice, legal advice. They don't know what they signed. They don't know the consequences of what they signed, and the effects it has had. And as a consequence of that, that is not a legally binding contract.
Go down that road, so all the will then be declared null and void.
Null and void. That's exactly right.
And then you come back to the table, the working table of the native title legislation. Remember, the A group, the B group, the C group. They're the collaborators.
That's right.
Of that legislation. And what we always have to be careful about are the collaborators amongst them.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. So what we've got here is we've got an organisation, a body of people who have now taken those steps on sovereignty. And they're taking them in small steps. We've been working on this now how many years? 4 years or something? You know, and we're sort of just, and they're the ones who are sort of running with this, and they've really got it. I go up there and we all workshop and we have little discussions about it and what is the next step, you know. So it's taking small steps, but in terms of those small steps, they are giant strides, yeah? And quite frankly, now, like my mob at home there with the Ualiai, right, we did the same thing, and we've taken small steps. The Queen wrote back to me, because the old people, and we got photographs, and all the people signed the papers to the Queen, where we did our UDI. The Queen wrote back to me as Gilla, leader of the Ualiai, not Michael Anderson, but Gilla, my tribal name. Now, she is recognised in the High Court over here as a foreign head of power, right? So, in law, when you do a UDI as an asserting independent nation state, the Queen has now tied Australia up by saying that she wrote to me a letter in response to all our documents and all the stuff that we asserted. She wrote back to me as Gilla, leader of the Ualiai Nation. So that what that does is puts us into a different legal category and a different position in the international law, in the international arena, because she's a foreign head of power. That's what that High Court said she is. Now, in the last 3 months,
I've had discussions with, I've written letters to, what's his name, Baird, before he resigned. Baird wrote back to me as Gillar leader of the Wailea Nation. His Secretary of Parliament, the Parliamentary Secretary, wrote to me as Gillar of the Wailea Nation. And the Minister for Aboriginal Affairs in New South Wales wrote to me as Gillar leader of the Wailea Nation. And they now want to deal with the issues that we put to them and said, you've got no authority in our country now. And in one of the letters that we sent to the Queen and to the Governor of New South Wales, we want all your police out of our state by the end of 2017. All your police. We will be taking over your courts and we will exercise authority under our law and culture. And so now the Premier's written to me. Now he's jumped out of the boat.
Yeah.
And he's left it to this other poor...
So that's why he resigned.
So he's left it to this other poor woman now who's got a, and the minister and her staff. The governor of New South Wales, what's his name? I should know his name. He's a soldier, probably. Yeah, you're right. Anyway, but 2 weeks before, 3 weeks before Christmas, he asked me to come to Government House in Canberra, in Sydney. And so I went and had a meeting with him and He said, I had a meeting with the Executive Council of State this morning and told him that I was meeting with you. And he said, I was just warned, watch that fella, he can twist you. So he said, I got a warning about you. He said, but I told him I'm meeting you anyway because I have an obligation, right? Because the obligation was now established by Queen Elizabeth II, his boss, right? And so he said, where do we start? I said, the first place you start is help me bury my dead. That's the first place I want you to start, where the massacre occurred. And I want you, as the governor, to get the parliament to read onto their parliamentary records that you killed our people, that you knew about it, that you failed to do a coronial inquiry into the massacre of the people, and that no one's ever buried them. Their bones are still laying there. And so he's now working with the military of Australia over here, the War Memorial. And what he's going to do is use what they used over in France, where they had to find the human remains, right? So they're going to use those things because they pick up human remains as opposed to animal remains, yeah. And they scan the area where you say the human remains are. So what we're going to do is he's now organising with the War Memorial here to now go and do that area. Look at where the area is, pick up the animal bones, separate them, and we're going to have a proper ceremony. But we won't do that until the New South Wales Parliament accepts what they've done and what happened. Now, what I haven't told him, and I'll tell you, is that massacre, they benefited, the Crown of England benefited from a proceed of a crime. And nobody is able to benefit and profit from a proceeds of a crime. And murder, there is no time limit on murder. And what happened there is murder. And so now we're going after them because he's a military man, he understands the need to bury the dead.
Yeah.
He understands that. And so what we're going to do, and we're going through that pathway. Now, in the meantime, we've defined all our territory, yeah? And now, white people out there, because we've defined our territory, we put in a native title claim and then we pulled it out. We did it simply because the people said we want them bastards to recognise who we are. So we put the native title claim in, then we mapped the area, they registered in the federal court, then when the court said, oh, we want evidence, they paid for all the genealogical connections, they paid for all the historical report. Soon as they completed all that, we pulled the native title claim out and said, see you later, Jack. That's our country. You just recognised us. Thank you very much. We've defined everything, so we've now got we're working on that level. Now, because we pulled it out and we discontinued it, it's still sitting on the records. And as a consequence of that action, it's now registered on every property within our defined area that there's a native title that's been discontinued, so no white fella out there now can buy any buyers for the land. No one's buying the land anymore. They've got properties up there for sale. They want to get out, right? And they're trying to sell the land, but they can't because that's registered on the title deeds now that there is a discontinued native title claim. And all of that land out there is Western land leases. Yeah, and that's what's killing them. And so they can't sell the land now because the land has been devalued. Just recently, a white fella over mining, white farmer, he lost his case over prospectors coming into on his land, yeah. Right? And so when he lost that case, as soon as he lost that case, the government, all the property owners started putting up their sale and said to the government, will you buy the bloody land from us? You buy it. So what's happened is the New South Wales government have bought two properties. We're doing a different, we're taking different steps, but we're all heading in the one direction,
yeah,
to become self-determining. Tell the whites to fuck off. You've got no jurisdiction on our country anymore. We're a sovereign people. We're a sovereign race. We have the right to self-determination. And what we said yesterday and what we read up here, the Australian government have got no authority over us exercising our rights. And we have to understand how to press those buttons, how to take that initiative and keep the bastards out of our place. And we're being successful in these steps, like with the Tri-Nation mob and now up in Cairns. They're right on, they're developing their business. I've got Fijians out on there right now who are on this country. What we've done is that we've given them sanctuary, and they're building a market garden for our whole communities, for all our communities around, Aboriginal communities. They're building market gardens. They don't have a right to be in Australia, but now they're on our country. No police is allowed on our country. And we've tested that at Brewarrina, where Barwon 4 is, they call it, the Aboriginal Reserve. It's on ULEO land on the northern side. We put a sign up there at the gate about 18 months ago. Put a sign up there, no unauthorised persons allowed. This includes police and government agencies.
Oh.
Yeah, and a sign by the community elders. It's got authorised by the ULEO Executive Council of State and most senior council of elders, and the elders of Barwon 4, right? And so we got names down the bottom where they can ring up and say if you want to come. When we put that up, all the police now and the government authorities, they ring up before they go on there, and the police have been instructed that they are not permitted to go onto that land or cross that grid to go into that community. Right, and so no police goes in there. The New South Wales Police Department have been ringing the Brewarrina people up and ringing me up, and they say, we want to meet with you because we need to take that sign down. We said, up you, Jack, we're not meeting with you at all. You know, that sign stays where it is. The good thing about that is that we said to the people when we had the community meeting, if someone mucks up on here, you've got to take responsibility. And one of the beauties is that the young fellas have stepped up and said, we get old people on here, we get young kids on here, you mess up here, we'll throw you out. Yeah. So the young ones have stepped up, they've had parties there, and the young ones, before they start their parties, these blokes go to their house and say, you make loud noise, we're going to throw you out of here. Yeah. And then they tell the young fellas in the community, you go over there and break the law in town, and you come back here and the policeman chasing you, we're going to throw you out that gate there, look, and we're going to throw you to him. Right? And they can have you. You do not use this place as a place of a safe haven for your crimes that you commit out there. Because you belong to us, you're our family. Now, the people are very happy now that they're moving in this direction, and the thing is that we're moving other people. We brought people in to help them lower their electricity rates. We've done that with people. We brought them in. When we brought these electricians in, who came there for nothing, worked with the community, turned down all the hot water systems, reconfigured their air conditionings in their houses for nothing, did all the relight bulbs and got all the Osram donated everything for nothing, did all that there, their electricity dropped by 60% in that community. And so we're working, because we've got to help our people in the community while we fight this political struggle as well.
Brother Boyd really said it. Land rights legislation for native title. The only way we're going to get our land is to occupy it and defend it.
That's right. By the way, before we go on, I just want to acknowledge something. We have two very important Aboriginal sportsmen here. They're very well known. And I really thank them for being here with us. Danny's an Olympian, a basketball Olympian. Danny myself. And we have the legend from Cronulla, the shark, Dave Peachy.
So I want to just acknowledge them and thank them for being here with us, eh? Yeah. Eddie.
What Michael was talking about now is the next step, nation building. So you've got this country, got everything there ready, that's building the nation. He is a nation, he said it. Now it's nation building. Now this is where the money come from.
Yeah, that's right.
And you're not going to miss too, though.
See how he's got the station back, right?
Yeah.
With us, it's going to be a little different. We want, when you get your land back and go sovereign like us now, you don't kick the white people off. Not all of them, only the useless ones. Okay, you've got a pastoralist here, you've got a mining there and all that. He said, no, stay there, brother. And it's part of us now, sit down money.
Yeah, stay there, brother.
See all their taxes and rents and rates.
Go to you.
Change direction now. Where to? Into your account, see? In there. Yeah. That's only partial. What about the farmers?
You
pumping out of our rivers, we can put a tax on it.
Yeah.
You pay the government the tax, but you're in our country now, so you pay it to us. That's every farmer, every pastoralist. The miners come in and say, hello. They say, no, you signed here, you are. Yeah, but we just went and overturned that, so now we want 50%. You can mine.
That's right.
We want 50% of the gold, and he's going to have some courage and learn a bit more and go for it. Kalgoorlie super pit, man.
Marissa's just got to finish off.
Can I ask one question first? When you were talking about the finding of the remains on the land, South Australia, when they built the Southern Freeway, right, they found remains. Right, then rather than divert, right, they moved the crew in, Brother Boy Tank New Church and the crew in. They showed I got with repatriation, that was that about. How do we get around that stuff? Well, how do we get them not disturb the bones, or do we have to do the repatriation?
No, we don't have to repatriate. You leave the people where they are.
All right, so how do we do that?
Well, we'll go through this process in a minute. Marissa, just let Marissa finish and then we'll...
Okay, so you don't just come out of the system. Like Uncle Eddie was saying, you're rebuilding now. You're rebuilding your nation. So each and every one of us, we have a slightly different nation. So where we are, it's rainforest and there's pastoral land and that's it. So what we did was we looked at all the land titles in the area. You go for the fights you can win. Pick your battles very smartly. Use this.
Yep.
Take back the land that you know you're going to get. Don't go squatting. Don't go doing...
They had a drone up there yesterday. Righto.
So it was a bit more complex than what I'm saying. We had to look at all the land tenure, work out what land you can take back first. This might be a bit hard, we'll leave that till later on. Look at what you can build on your land. And so you need to find people in your tribe, look at the experiences they have.
Yep.
So we have a few scientists, so they look at the land, the soil, what we can grow, all of that kind of stuff. Then we look at what structures we can put up, because where we are, it's very highly prone to cyclones. So we have to take, you have to take everything into consideration when you're rebuilding your nation. Where are the elders going to live? Where do they want to live? How are you catering to them? How are you catering to people in my generation? How are you catering to the little kids? What kind of education structure are you setting up? So you have to think of all of this. You don't just go into it blindfolded.
Yeah.
Think about your entire nation, who's in your nation, because remember, they're all members of that nation. The elders have a responsibility to every member in that nation. You have to provide for them. So you have to think about everyone in that nation, and within your nation you have to work collectively. So I'll let Uncle Eddie talk about what we're doing. We're setting up a nursery to set up medicinal medicines, so people like me who can't use Medicare, and we're working on
the farm, nation building farm, housing community,
rehabilitation.
Eddie, can you just
the next step now is the nation building. So we're not as smart as the younger generation, but what we do now, we can start off. So we're starting off, my sister's out there doing the nursery. People want to rehabilitate old farm, old mining areas and that, and she's getting paid for that, so she's making the money. So we're going to work together. I've got And by the way, her little block is 800 acres. Only one. So my block is 14, only one. But I got other blocks in there. So I can have a farm. We're setting up a farm. My brother-in-law moving with the things that government can't say no to and still get their money. So we're taking our young people off the streets back on country again. See, the thing with the government, they have rehab and do a great job in rehab. After that, straight back into the environment again, eh? We pick them up from there, take them out of country. And see how Michael's talking? The young fellow's blab, we're going to chuck. See, the authority's back in the elders' hands again.
Yes.
Where the government took it off us, didn't you?
Yep.
Yes.
So we're working in that area. We're going to take our kids, not the child safety. Yeah. We're taking them. They've got no right over their kids.
That's right.
Yeah. So we're going to do all that. So we're going to set everything up for the next generation. You know, our next generation, we got doctors, we got lawyers, we got teachers and all that. So yesterday we talked about educational thing coming on our country, an international one. Yeah. So they can go from prep to uni free, on country with our own curriculum.
Yeah.
Suited for us,
yeah.
Applicable. Us.
Yeah. Applicable
to us. Yeah. So you go to uni here, you got to pay thousands in debt, and they only let you learn what they want you to do. You won't learn sovereignty there, but you come into ours, you will. It's going to be drummed into. So we're looking to the younger generation.
If I can,
and now partnership, you can do this in steps, but with partnership, you go in leaps and bounds. So we've got international and national partners. One deals with solar, one deals with recycling water, one deals with all green energy. The government can't say no, you don't put that on me. We're getting away from coal, and they can build a grid where we all have electricity free.
Yeah.
Our farms, all fruit and veggie free. Oh. We've got cattle station, or the parsons say, well, you want to stay to give us half your... We want a killer every day for our people. Even free, brother. Even free yourself, no bills. Plus, sit down money coming into your account.
Yeah.
So you'd be rich, brother. You'd be making money whether you sleep.
Well, I'll just let you know. Well, Norisa's got one more thing.
Just the last point. So the elders, they make all our decisions for us. That's the final stop. So you need to look at your different generations, because in each generation you learn different things. So the young people like myself, we learn about technology, how to cross-reference the acts. You can't expect the elders to learn that stuff and to sit down there and read an act that thick. That's not on. So what we do at our meetings and when we gather together, the young people come with solutions. We talk about it with the elders. The elders say yes or no, that's not going to work according to culture. And then they send the young people away. Okay, go and look at that, go and look at this. Then in the next meeting, we come back and we look at what we've discussed in the previous meeting. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is...
Wisdom banks?
Hey?
Like wisdom banks.
Yeah, yeah.
Banks of wisdom.
Well, you're working together. Yeah. Not one person's better than the other. Not one person knows more than the other. You have to work together. Yeah. That's the unity. It's the only way it's going to work. Yeah.
But it's spread across the generation.
Yeah. And just because I'm
That's
out
awesome.
Of the system, that doesn't give me the right to speak over an elder, to give abuse to an elder. You need to know your place. That's what I'm trying to say.
Right. Just before you got one thing, and then by Marbuck, and then we got another speaker over here.
Yeah, you got your name.
Talk up so we all can hear him.
General question is that now you've got your land in that. Is there an economic restoration from the government for what they've done wrong, or are you going to rebuild that yourself as well?
From this government, no. But we've got plans now. Me, Michael, and a few others, we're going to the horse's mouth, or the funnel. The Queen's got it all.
Yes.
Remember, she's got copyright even on your birthright. She's got copyright on everything. She's getting money from our land, our money, over there in the big vault.
And we'll talk about that in a minute, eh?
Yeah, that's okay then.